Winter is coming, and as the saying goes, make hay while the sun shines, or rather, prepare your sled in summer and your cart in winter. Soon, snow will cover everything, and temperatures could drop to 40°C. Hello, friends. What's up? Today, as always, I've got an unusual project and two new tools I'm using. All I need for materials are some pipes of different diameters. I could have used regular metal, but I decided to go with stainless steel. I've never really worked with it before, so it's time to learn. The steel I'm using is AISI 304, a high alloy austenitic steel. It contains at least 18% chromium and 10% nickel, with iron as the base component, plus manganese and copper as additional alloying elements. Now, for the first new tool I'll be using today. It's packed really well, and I'm impressed with the kit. It's got everything I need, even some extra consumables. Here, it is a real beauty. I had it up and running in a minute, and its color is just gorgeous, my favorite turquoise. It has a self-diagnosis feature when powered on. I love that the machine displays everything on the screen. No old-fashioned needle gauges, super convenient. It even has a handy setting for blowback interval and arc interval. The pilot arc ignites without needing to touch the ground. The torch is as simple as it gets. It's got a central replaceable electrode with a hole. Then the nozzle screws on top of the electrode, followed by a protective ceramic cap. This machine can cut through thin metal like nothing. No need to even try. But what about something a little thicker? Based on the metal's thickness, I set the current and air parameters. It cuts through like a hot knife through butter. The video speaks for itself. Sometimes I do projects with aluminum, so let's see how it cuts through that. This isn't a thin sheet either. It's got some serious thickness. I tested it, and now I'll use it for the stainless steel project. It cuts through that too. My go-to helper on projects is my 3D printer. I use it not only for parts, but also for various templates, which turns out to be super convenient. The precision is amazing, everything fits snugly. Using the template, I faced off the pipe and cut the exact length I needed for the project, 330 millimeters from edge to edge. For marking holes in the bulkheads, I also used a printed template. No need to find the center or draw anything. When designing the template, I left the centers of the future holes. All I had to do was lay it on the workpiece and punch it with a center punch. Everything turned out precise and neat. I drilled all the holes using hole saws for metal. I found a new type of hole saw that I now use regularly. Sure, I could have used a step drill bit, but sometimes it jams too much. I cleaned up all the edges on my homemade belt sander. It's always by my side and ready to help out in a pinch. This sander was one of my projects that sparked a lot of debate in the comments under the video where I made it. Everything's prepped. Now it's time to assemble it all. Let's weld some stainless steel. Oh right, the welding machine is new too. Here it is. It's a multi-purpose MIG welder with tons of features and capabilities. I picked it because it's small and light, compatible with a 1 kg spool. It can weld with or without gas. It's got TIG mode for argon welding, and of course, you can stick weld too. It's smart, controlled with adjustable settings. It even came with two spools of wire, one flux cord and one solid. I can't wait to try it out. First, I'll try welding 1 mm thick metal with flux cord wire, no gas. I'm no expert welder, but these smart machines are made for folks like me. I'm doing it with tack welds to avoid burning through the thin metal. The flux in the wire spatters a bit, but that's normal. Basically, it's like an electrode, just thin, long, and the flux is inside. Everything welded perfectly. Now I'll switch to CO and regular wire. Quickly swap the spool and make a corner weld on thin metal. For some reason, corner welds have always been tricky for me. I also welded two profiles together with a long weld. It came out great. Not the straightest, but solid and high quality. But my project is stainless steel, and I've got stainless wire. To ensure perfect alignment during assembly, I printed guides again. They'll hold the bulkheads in place for the initial welds. I'll tack a few in place, then weld the rest, however, is most convenient on the workbench. There are 7 pipes in the design, 1 in the center, and 6 evenly spaced around it, each 260 mm long. For better efficiency, I could add more pipes or lengthen them, but I'm keeping things compact for now. I'll see how well this version transfers heat and whether I'll need to tweak it. I cleaned up all the welds to make them neat, and since they need to be airtight, I had to test for cracks. After some trial and error, I found the best method for me. I coated the surface with chalk, calcium carbonate, a form of limestone, which shows defects well when wet. Then, I sprayed some penetrating lubricant on the other side, and it found any tiny holes instantly. After waiting a bit, I had to touch up a couple of spots with micro cracks. In the middle of the large pipe, there'll be a sealed section with pipes running through it, also airtight. I cut end caps for the large pipe ahead of time for the top and bottom. Hot exhaust gas will pass through these sections, cooling as it flows through the thin pipes, releasing valuable heat. I cleaned up all the burrs on the parts, of course. Makes work more pleasant, looks professional, and you won't accidentally cut yourself. Since the heat exchanger will connect via 5/8-inch hoses, I'll make the inlet and outlet of the liquid chamber with 16mm pipes. I'm hoping the silicone hoses can handle the temperature. Here's how the welds look on the bottom. To make the resonator connection easier, I just welded it to the intake pipe. Even though the exhaust pipe was less than 1mm thick, it all came together without burns and looks pretty clean. After welding, stainless steel leaves dirty welds and heat tint around the edges. I decided to try a cool method for cleaning them up. I ordered this brush for $3. It's made of conductive carbon fibers, I think similar to those in heating cables. To use it, you need an electrolyte solution. I'm using regular battery acid from an auto shop. And a power source. The positive clamp goes on the workpiece, the negative on the brush. At low current, I cleaned up all the unsightly spots and wiped them down with a baking soda solution to neutralize the acid. It's all set. Now, it's time to test it. I didn't go overboard with polishing the casing, but I did run a felt disc over it with the grinder to make it look nice. First run, I hooked it all up to my heater from the last video. Filled the system with water. In summer, it cools. In winter, it'll heat. My diesel heater powered by 12 volts. The exhaust from the heater is extremely hot and it just gets vented outside. Why waste such valuable heat? The heat exchanger's principle is simple. Hot exhaust gas passes through the heat exchanger, heating the liquid circulating in a closed system, and the radiators transfer that heat to the air in the room. By the time the gas exits the heat exchanger, it's much cooler and is safely vented outside. I've connected everything roughly for now, still need to set up a proper exhaust condensate drain. But it's working great. I'm loving working with stainless steel. And now I've got a significant savings on heating for years to come. Guys, if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to hit the like button. As always, I'll leave all the useful links from the video in the description. Come back soon. There's plenty more interesting stuff on my channel. Wishing you all the best and good health to you and your loved ones. Thanks for watching this video. See you next time.